So good evening everyone, this is Dr. Vineet Sehgal and welcome to this special class on glaucoma. So this class, we were scheduled to take it yesterday because of some network issues and some clinical issues. I was not able to basically take the session yesterday, so I would be taking this session today. So those students who are the plus subscribers, welcome to this session. In this session, you would get the extra edge from the already courses that you are going on. Those who are not the plus subscribers and the free subscribers, you can have an advantage of the plus subscription or the iconic subscription, where you would have the additional advantage of the prep letter also. So a lot of batches which are going on, like the FMG batch that is going on with the top educators, the INICET 24 day MCQ marathon batch that is also going on. And you can see it by downloading the Unacademy Learning app, and you can get a 10% discount on whatever course that you basically go for and basically subscribe for. So with this, I would be starting my session today. Before I start the session, this is the compulsory voice and the audio check. Am I audible to all of you? Just give me a thumbs up. Okay, chalo. So we would basically start our session with a glaucoma case scenario. So the first case scenario is there. Harish, let's say a 65-year-old male, he came to the OPD with chief complaints of halos and blurring of vision. So what is our first hint? The patient is having halos and blurring of vision. If anyone is not very comfortable with English, you can write it in the comment section. I can explain it in Hindi as well. So halos and blurring of vision. The intraocular pressure was 25 millimeter of mercury. Cup disc ratio was 0.8 and the patient was having a bayonetting sign positive. The patient was sent for investigations and found to have occludable angles. Okay, so these are the hints. So see it once again. Halos and blurring of vision, 25 millimeter mercury pressure, cup disc ratio 0.8:1, bayonetting sign positive, and occludable angle. So these are the hints given. Now we would ask some questions based on these hints. Okay, chalo. So first of all, let's say this is the whole optic nerve head. You can just understand it like it is like a boiled egg. So the yellow portion that you are seeing, this yellow portion, this I call it cup. Okay, and this whole egg I call it disc. Do you understand this, everyone? What is the cup and what is the disc? So everything is included in the optic nerve head or optic disc. In the central yellow excavated portion, that is called cup. Now, what this white area, can you appreciate this white area? So this is called neuroretinal rim. Now, do you understand this? Give me a thumbs up. What is neuroretinal rim? Now, very important, this neuroretinal rim is, it is maximum in the inferior quadrant, followed by the superior, followed by the nasal, and followed by the temporal. So this is an isNet rule which is there followed for the thickness of the neuroretinal rim. So if you can see in this picture, so this yellowish area, this is quite big. And you can see in this patient, the inferior neuroretinal rim is thinner. If you can appreciate this, give me a thumbs up. So I can say that the inferior neuroretinal rim is thin in this patient as compared to the superior neuroretinal rim. So this patient may be having a glaucoma. Okay, chalo. So with this, what is the diagnosis of the case? Your options are primary open angle glaucoma, anterior uveitis, primary angle closure glaucoma, or immature senile cataract. Try to answer. So those friends who have just joined late, I'm just telling you the case scenario. 65-year-old male, halos and blurring of vision, 25 millimeter of mercury, eye pressure, bayonetting sign positive, and occludable angles. Okay, these are the hints of this question. So this question, basically, if the patient is definitely having a glaucoma because there is a 0.8 cup disc ratio, anything which is more than 0.3, or so I write it, if cup disc ratio is more than 0.3:1, okay, if it is more than 0.3:1 or there is a asymmetry of the disk. So asymmetry means, let's say one eye it is 0.3 and other eye it is 0.5. okay, if the there is a asymmetry of the disk, this means the patient is having a high chances of getting a glaucoma. Okay, the patient may have high chances of getting a glaucoma. Here also you are getting one more sign. The name of the sign was bayonetting sign. So what is bayonetting sign? Can anyone tell me? So bayonetting sign, if you can appreciate, if this is the neuroretinal rim, this is the cup, okay, this is the disc, this is the disc, the inside is the cup, and if we have a blood vessel which is turning at the margins of the cup, can you see, taking a turn at the margins of the cup, this is called bayonetting sign. If you understand, just give me a thumbs up. A similar sign is called bearing of blood vessels. So normally the blood vessels, they do not basically pass horizontally through the cup. But if you are getting a vessel like this, which was earlier not visible, but now visible, this is called bearing of blood vessel. So this is another sign of the patient having glaucoma. Okay, another sign. Can you tell me any other sign for glaucoma? So another glaucoma sign is that if you are getting a hemorrhage on the disc. Okay, so if you are getting a hemorrhage on the disc, this is also a sign of glaucoma. One more I have basically told you earlier, that is the thinning of neuroretinal rim. Thinning of neuroretinal rim. And sometimes normally what happens is that the nerve fibers basically pass through the pores of the sclera. These pores of the sclera are usually not visible. Okay, but if you are seeing some black pores, grayish pores of the sclera, which are visible to the outside, I call it a laminar dot sign. Are you getting my point, Dr. Adarsh? I call it laminar dot sign. Okay, then we have another sign where our blood vessels, they basically shift to the nasal side. Okay, this is called nasal shifting of the vessels. So all of these are the hints of the patient suffering from glaucoma. Now the question is whether this patient is a open angle or this patient is a closed angle. So whether this is patient is a open angle glaucoma or this patient is a angle closure glaucoma. So for this, what I need to do is, I need to do a gonioscopy. I will tell you more about the gonioscopy in our further slides. And I see whether the patient is having a open angles or the patient is having a occludable angles. Are you getting my point, Dr. Nia? So if the patient is having a occludable angles, this means the patient is suffering from primary angle closure glaucoma. So hint, so those students who have just joined now, I told you the case scenario. So the patient is having the occludable angles, and because the patient is having the occludable angles, this patient is suffering from primary angle closure glaucoma. Is it clear, everyone? Why the answer is primary angle closure glaucoma in this case? Chal, let's move to our next question. Okay, so next questions are halos. They are manifestations of both glaucoma and immature senile cataract. To differentiate between the term, between both of them, which test can be used? Your options are photostress test, Fincham test, Amsler grid test, or Pentacam. Try to answer. So this test is basically called a Fincham's test. Now, what exactly is the Fincham test? I have basically told you again and again. So this is a slit. So whenever you are having a slit, only a light can pass through a slit, nothing else. So if the patient is having a corneal edema, okay, if the patient is having an angle closure glaucoma, and through this the patient is having a corneal edema, this corneal edema would be all around the cornea. So whole cornea would be edematous, and whenever the light goes through the edematous cornea, it would break into many parts. This would cause basically the halos. Are you getting my point? So whether the slit is at the temporal part, nasal part, or in the center of the cornea, there would be halos from everywhere. But if the patient is having an immature senile cataract, in that case, if the slit is at the point where there is no opacity, there is a clear lens, there would not be any halos. But when the light, when the slit is in the basically correlation in the same axis of the opacity, in that case there would be halos. Similarly, when the slit moves to again to that area where there is a no opacity, there is a clear lens, so there also there would be no halos. So can I say, Dr. Mohan, that Fincham test, basically what it helps is that in immature senile cataract or in a nuclear cataract, what it does is it causes the breaking of halos. So halos are present in some areas and absent in other areas. But when you do it with the corneal edema, a patient of primary angle closure glaucoma, all throughout the corneal region, all throughout the axis of the eyeball, there would be halos. So this is basically called Emslay-Fincham test. Are you getting my point? What is the Emslay-Fincham test? Chal. Let's move to the next test. What is this test called? This test is basically used for the home monitoring of the ARMD patients. Do not confuse it with another similar type of test, which is called Amsler-Dubois test. I'm not talking about the Amsler-Dubois test here. This test, which is used for the patients of ARMD, these are called Amsler-Grid test. Okay. Then we have the next test, which is basically called Pentacam. So can you tell me which corneal disease we can diagnose with the help of Pentacam? So the answer here is any corneal ectatic disorders like this, ectasias. So the most important one is, as Dr. Asif has told us, keratoconus. Okay, so we can diagnose keratoconus with the help of Pentacam. Also, it is a very, very essential tool before getting a LASIK surgery done. So it is also used in pre-op evaluation of a patient who has to undergo a refractive surgery. Are you getting my point, Dr. Mishra? Okay, so pre-op evaluation of any refractive surgery, this is a very, very important test, which is called Pentacam. Chal. Let's move to the next question. So IOP of this patient is 25 millimeter of mercury. This was the first sign of glaucoma. So what is the gold standard for measuring the intraocular pressures? So welcome my interns who have joined this session. This session would be also useful for you who are in the clinics and doing the glaucoma evaluation regularly of my patients. So your options are Schiotz, Goldman, Tonopen, and Triggerfish. Try to answer. So any of my intern, if he is basically attending this session, just give me a thumbs up in the comment section so that I know it. So I can tell you the more clinically relevant points. Any third year student also, if there who is attending this session, also just give me a thumbs up so that I know it. So आंसर हेयर इज गोल्डमैन एप्लेनेशन टोनोमेट्री। गोल्डमैन एप्लेनेशन टोनोमेट्री, अ वेरी वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट क्वेश्चन, सो मेनी टाइम्स आस्क टू यू एंड सो मच क्लिनिकली रेलिवेंट। सो हैव यू सीन दिस गोल्डमैन एप्लेनेशन टोनोमेट्री इन माई क्लिनिक? सो वॉट इज दिस पार्ट कॉल्ड? आई एम जस्ट एनलार्जिंग इट। वॉट इज दिस पार्ट कॉल्ड? दिस पार्ट इज कॉल्ड प्रिज्म। वेरी गुड, दिस पार्ट इज कॉल्ड प्रिज्म। एंड कैन यू टेल मी विच इंस्ट्रूमेंट इट इज माउंटेड अपॉन? वॉट इज दिस इंस्ट्रूमेंट विच इज माउंटेड अपॉन? सो दिस इज बेसिकली, वेरी गुड आशुतोष, दिस इज कॉल्ड स्लिट लैम्प। नाउ कैन यू टेल मी इफ आई हैव टू डू अ एप्लेनेशन टोनोमेट्री, वुड इट आई डू इट इन अ ब्राइट रूम और इन अ डार्क रूम? सो वॉट आई टेल माई पीसीटी बिफोर आई डू अ टोनोमेट्री? सो वेरी गुड डॉक्टर केतकी, वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट पॉइंट हेयर इज दैट ऑल द इन्वेस्टिगेशन विच आई डू विद द हेल्प ऑफ स्लिट लैम्प, these are the dark room procedures. So sometimes the question is asked for third year students, what are the various dark room procedures? So any instrumentation which is done with the slit lamp, whether it is an applanation tonometry, slit lamp examination, whether it is a gonioscopy, all these are dark room procedures. Okay, even the direct and the indirect ophthalmoscopy, these are the dark room procedures. Okay, now this applanation tonometer, why this is called applanation tonometer? Because this basically gets in touch with the cornea. It does not basically depress it. Okay, so earlier there was an instrument where a foot plate was basically used, which used to deform the shape of the cornea. Can you tell me what was this instrument called? It was looking like this. So this is a Goldman applanation tonometry. I call it in short form GAT. And this one, as Dr. Sneha have told us, this is a Schiotz tonometry. It is called a Schiotz tonometry. Okay, chalo. What is this instrument called? You must have seen this in my clinic also. So this tonometer, which I rarely use more in the patients who are basically having a corneal scarring, or sometimes even I use it in the pediatric patients during the examination under anesthesia. This is, as Ashutosh has told us, this is called tonopen. So what is the difference between the tonopen and applanation tonometer? Does it need a slit lamp? Yes or no? So the answer is no. It does not use a slit lamp. This is one of the main advantage, Ashutosh. Second advantage, Dr. Pritam, is that this tip, can you see this tip? I'm just enlarging it a bit. Okay, so this is basically this tip. If you have a cornea, let's say this cornea is having a corneal opacity here. Okay, I cannot basically use an applanation tonometer because this is a scarred cornea. So this tip, I can touch it here, okay, and I can see the intraocular pressure at even peripheral area of the cornea. Are you getting my point, Asif, Dr. Prem, everyone? So this can even be used even if I have a slightest bit of the clear cornea and the reading comes here. Okay, it is like a digital thermometer. The reading of IOP comes here, let's say 18 millimeter of mercury. Okay, so that is the very, very much advantage of this tonometer, which is typically used in the patients who are having a scarred cornea. A very, very important question. Okay, chalo, let's move to our next slide. What is this instrument called? This basically is something, I press it, tuck, and goes back. So like this. So this is an instrument. How it takes pressure? It comes. Microsecond, it touches the eye and goes back. What is this instrument called? The patient can use this instrument also at home. There is no anesthesia required in this patient. Just touching it and going back. हैव यू हर्ड द नेम ऑफ सेल्फ टोनोमीटर और हैव यू हर्ड द नेम ऑफ रिबाउंड टोनोमीटर? दिस इज कॉल्ड अ सेल्फ टोनोमीटर एंड रिबाउंड टोनोमीटर. कैन यू सी वन पार्ट बेसिकली आई एम टचिंग इट एट द फोरहेड, ओके, रेस्टिंग देयर, एंड द अदर वन दिस विद द हेल्प ऑफ अ वेरी प्रेशर सेंसिटिव नीडल, इट गोज टचेस द कॉर्निया एंड कम्स बैक. इट डज नॉट बेसिकली रेस्ट ऑन द कॉर्निया. दिस इज कॉल्ड सेल्फ टोनोमीटर और रिबाउंड टोनोमीटर. इन दिस कोविड एरा दिस कैन बी अ वेरी वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट क्वेश्चन दैट इफ द पेशेंट इज नॉट एबल टू कम टू द क्लिनिक एंड इफ यू वॉन्ट टू गिव द ऑप्शन ऑफ अ टोनोमीटर टू अ पेशेंट दैट यू कैन थ्रू दैट गेट योर आईओपी चेक एट योर होम इटसेल्फ. वॉट इज दैट इंस्ट्रूमेंट? सो रिमेंबर that instrument is called self tonometer or rebound tonometer. A very important point is it does not use any anesthesia. In other ones we need to have a topical anesthesia, but because it basically touches the eye floor just microseconds, let's say 0.1 second, so I do not need an anesthesia there. That is the main advantage where the patient can use it even at home. Are you getting my point, Dr. Anita? So the patient can use it himself, putting it gun here, tuck, and the IOP is taken. Okay? No, the readings are not very much accurate as compared to applanation tonometry, but still you would get some correlation. Okay? In this COVID scenario, something is better than nothing. Okay, chal, let's move to our next tonometer. This is called diatonic tonometer. The basic advantage of, can you see this ring here? Semicircular ring. So this you can rest even on the eyelids. So when the patient has gone a penetrating keratoplasty, I also call it corneal transplant, or if the patient is having a corneal ulcer, let's say the patient has undergone a tarsorrhaphy, in these patients this can basically rest on the lids and basically measure the eye pressure. So very important use of this tonometer is it does not basically even touches the cornea. So this is called transpalpebral tonometer. Are you getting my point? Just give me a thumbs up. So this is called transpalpebral tonometer or diatonic tonometer. Okay. Now my next question is investigation to diagnose patient having closed angles. Your options are direct ophthalmoscopy, indirect ophthalmoscopy, perimetry, or gonioscopy. Try to answer. So the answer here is D, that is gonioscopy. Remember, gonioscopy, anterior segment OCT, ultrasonic biomicroscopy, these are the various investigations which can be used to measure the angles. Okay, what are actually the angles of the eyeball? This is your cornea, this is your iris. Through this area there is a trabecular meshwork through which the aqueous outflow takes place. Now this area, if it is not basically patent, this is called occludable angles. So what happens if this is your cornea and you have an iris which is like this? So can you see these angles? Can you see these angles are so small that the drainage is not possible there? This is called occludable angles, or I also call it closed angles. Are you getting my point? Now, sometimes what they ask is, what is the definition of occludable angles? So definition of occludable angles, you remember, what is the definition of closed angles? Can anyone tell me? I tell you so many times during my plus courses and during my clinics. So closed angles, the definition is, this is the eyeball, 360 degree of eye, 360 degree. Out of 360 degree, when I do gonioscopy, in gonioscopy, if 270 degree or more than 270 degree of trabecular meshwork is not visible, is not visible on gonioscopy, this phenomena is called angle closure. Are you getting my point, Dr. Neeraj, Dr. Vidisha, Dr. Rajesh? So gonioscopy mein closed angle ki investigation of choice kya hogi? Gonioscopy. Gonioscopy mein agar 3/4 of the gonioscope mein aapke posterior trabecular meshwork nahi dikhai de raha hai, usko hum angle closure glaucoma kehte hain. Aaya samajh mein aap logon ko? Okay, so if you can see here, this is a gonioscopy that I am doing, and this gonioscopy I have basically hold it in my hand, okay, and this is what we are seeing here. Can you see this picture? This is a gonioscopy picture going seen here, and if you can appreciate, can you appreciate this band, everyone? Can you see this band? So this band is basically trabecular meshwork. So if this trabecular meshwork is visible, this means this is an open angle. Are you getting my point? So agar trabecular meshwork nahi dikh raha hai, sirf white or iris dikhai de rahi hai, to usko angle closure kehte hain. Otherwise, isko open angle kehte hain. Are you getting my point, Dr. Anita? Okay. So this is the difference between the open angle and angle closure glaucoma. Okay. Let's show you one more question so that everything gets more aligned. Okay, so this is my next question. Mark the correct sequence of gonioscopic structures from cornea to the iris. I just tell you about this question. This is your cornea. This is your root of iris. Okay, from where the iris starts. And here are few structures. Okay, here we have the trabecular meshwork. So these are the structures. This is your cornea, end of the cornea, or I would say end of the Descemet's membrane of the cornea. And here we have the ciliary body band. So these structures I am asking from cornea to the iris. Are you getting my question? So एंटीरियर से लेके पोस्टीरियर तक जाना है, आपको बताना है सीक्वेंस ऑफ स्ट्रक्चर्स क्या है. सो योर ऑप्शंस आर श्वेलबेस लाइन फॉलोड बाय स्क्लेरल स्पर फॉलोड बाय ट्रबेक्युलर मेशवर्क रूट ऑफ आयरिस सिलरी बॉडी और श्वेलबेस लाइन ट्रबेक्युलर मेशवर्क रूट ऑफ आयरिस स्क्लेरल स्पर सिलरी बॉडी श्वेलबेस लाइन ट्रबेक्युलर मेशवर्क स्क्लेरल स्पर सिलरी बॉडी रूट ऑफ आयरिस श्वेलबेस लाइन रूट ऑफ आयरिस स्क्लेरल स्पर trabecular meshwork, Schlemm's canal or ciliary body. Try to answer. ओके, सो यहां पर आपको एक चीज ध्यान रखनी है. द स्ट्रक्चर्स, द फर्स्ट स्ट्रक्चर इज वेयर द डेस्मेंड मेम्ब्रेन ऑफ द कॉर्निया एंड्स. व्हाट इज दैट कॉल्ड? एंड ऑफ द डेस्मेंड मेम्ब्रेन ऑफ द कॉर्निया. सो दैट इज कॉल्ड श्वेलबेज लाइन. हैव यू हर्ड द नेम श्वेलबेज लाइन? गिव मी अ थम्स अप. सो फर्स्ट इज द श्वेलबेज लाइन. आफ्टर द श्वेलबेज लाइन द नेक्स्ट वन इज द पोर्स थ्रू विच द एक्वस ह्यूमर बेसिकली ड्रेन्स. वॉट इज दैट कॉल्ड? दैट इज कॉल्ड ट्रेबेक्यूलर मेशवर्क. After the trabecular meshwork, there is a whitish band. Okay? So basically, it is a spur-like structure like this. Looks like a whitish band on gonioscopy. What is that called? That is called scleral spur. Okay? After the scleral spur, we have the next structure, which is called the band formed by the ciliary body. Ciliary body band. And in the end, we have the root of the iris. Okay, so our structures are, if only Schwalbe's line is visible, the angles are closed. If trabecular meshwork is present, angles are open. If scleral spur is present, angles are definitely 100% open. If the ciliary body band and root of iris, they are also visible, this means the patient is having a very deep anterior chamber. Are you getting my point? So the basic funda is Schwalbe's line, trabecular meshwork, scleral spur, ciliary body band, and root of iris. This is the way the structures are seen in the gonioscopy. Okay, so if you can see here, just if you can appreciate, can you see this structure, everyone? So here, this area, here you would get a Schwalbe's line. Then you have the trabecular meshwork. Can you see the trabecular meshwork? And then the whitish area which you are seeing, this is the scleral spur. I would basically put in the Unacademy Telegram group a picture where the root of iris as well as the ciliary band is also visible. But in this patient, you are seeing definitely a open angles. Okay. This is basically a gonioscopy picture. Okay, Dr. Anirudh, Dr. Revati. Chalo. Let's move to our next question of the day. Okay. So now, what is the procedure of choice in this patient? So those students who have just joined now, I have basically told you how to diagnose a patient of primary angle closure glaucoma. My next question is, what is the procedure of choice for treatment in the primary angle closure glaucoma? Your options are latanoprost, pilocarpine, YAG iridotomy, or trabeculectomy. Try to answer. So this patient is basically suffering from primary angle closure glaucoma. And remember, in primary angle closure glaucoma, what is happening is that the iris is basically coming in front and blocking the trabecular meshwork. So what you have to do here is you have to just make a small hole in the iris. What this hole in the iris would do is this would basically cause an alternate flow, area of flow for the aqueous humor to go from the anterior chamber, from the posterior chamber to the anterior chamber. Now this area, which is behind the iris, this is called posterior chamber. And Ritu, the area which is in front of the iris, this is called anterior chamber. So it makes a communication between the posterior chamber and the anterior chamber. This makes the anterior chamber more open, and this causes the trabecular meshwork to become patent. So this is the procedure of choice in the patient of angle closure glaucoma. Now, here is the basic main difference that I want to tell you. देर आर थ्री डिफरेंट टाइप्स ऑफ ग्लोकोमा वेयर देयर कंफ्यूजन अकर्स इन द मैनेजमेंट. द फर्स्ट वन इज अ प्राइमरी ओपन एंगल ग्लोकोमा, द सेकेंड वन इज अ प्राइमरी एंगल क्लोजर ग्लोकोमा, एंड द थर्ड वन इज एक्यूट कंजेस्टिव ग्लोकोमा. नाउ वॉट इज द डिफरेंस बिटवीन दैम? The management of all of them is basically different. So first of all, if the patient is having a primary open angle glaucoma, the management here would be just a medical management. You decrease the IOP. If the patient is not controlled on the IOP, then go with the surgical procedure. The first thing I do here is I basically just give the PG analogs. Or I would just give the medical management to the patient. Okay, this is the simplest of the thing that I would do in this patient. The patient would be beautifully controlled. I do not need to do anything. Then the second is I see the patient is having the signs of glaucoma, 25 pressure, and the patient is having an angle closure glaucoma. What I would do in this patient, the patient is having a, let's say, 25 millimeter of mercury pressure. There is no corneal edema there. I would start the patient on, let's say, pilocarpine or an anti-glaucoma medication and do the definitive procedure, making a hole in the iris. I call this procedure as iridotomy. Can you tell me what is the laser that I use in an iridotomy? I use a very, very important laser, ND-YAG laser for the iridotomy. Very good, Dr. Bismillah. Now, the problem is, let's say the patient is having an acute congestive glaucoma. Acute congestive glaucoma means the patient is having a, let's say, 60 millimeter of mercury pressure. He comes to the OPD. He is having a lot of pain. He is having a lot of corneal edema, and you are not able to see even the iris. So what you do in these cases is you basically start putting the patient on some drug which would cause the decrease of IOP at once, at scat. That one drug has to be given systemically, because the corneal edema would not basically allow the topical medications to pass through the cornea. Cornea allow hi nahi karegi eye drop ko uske pass through hone ke liye. To fir isliye humko patient ko jo hai systemically koi drug deni padegi. Kya drug denge hum usko? Jo immediate pressure kam kare. To sabse pehle jaise Ashutosh ne bataya, I would start the patient on IV mannitol. If I do not have the facility of IV mannitol, then I would basically give acetazolamide, or I can also give systemic glycerol to the patient. So these as hyperosmotics, they would decrease the vitreous volume, and immediately the patient's pressure, eye pressure would come down. As soon as the eye pressure would come down, the edema would decrease, the cornea would become more percolating to the drugs. I would start the patient on the medical management, and finally jab uska eye pressure, corneal edema kam ho gaya, uski inflammation kam ho gayi, to finally main usko iridotomy karunga. So can you appreciate, Dr. Prem, that I would not do a regular immediate iridotomy in this patient as we have done in a angle closure patient. Okay, everyone fine? All of you understand this concept? Give me a thumbs up. So much important. Okay, chalo. Let's move to a picture of iridotomy. So this is a patient where I have done an iridotomy. Can you see this area? So usually I prefer this area for iridotomy, and this is my next question. Okay, laser used in doing YAG iridotomy, I already told you. ND YAG iridotomy, okay. So which of the following is the preferred pay place for doing a iridotomy? Your options are 11 to 1 o'clock position. Okay, so this is, let's say, the iris. So whether I would do it in 11 to 1 o'clock position, I would do it in 9 o'clock position, 3 o'clock position, or 6 o'clock position. Try to answer. So in which area I would prefer doing this iridotomy? I have just showed you the picture also. So I would basically prefer doing this iridotomy in the superior quadrant here. You would ask me, sir, why? Remember, this iridotomy is done. What it does is it makes the hole in the iris. So So I have to make it, I am basically injuring the iris, making a hole there. I am doing some inflammation here. So I would definitely do it in the area which has the thinnest iris. Okay. So sclera does not cover it. The eyelid cover it, Anita. So basically I would do it in the thinnest part of the iris. So what is the thinnest part of the iris called? Thinnest part of the iris are called crypts. Okay. So let's say this is the iris. These areas where there is a thinning of iris, this is called crypts. Are you getting my point? Okay. So first thing, I would do it in the thinnest part of the iris. And second thing, I would do it in that position. Okay, if I am making a hole. So can you appreciate this is another type of something of a pupil that I have made. So if the light also goes through this pupil, what it would cause is it would basically cause a diplopia type of image. So I would prefer it in some place which is covered by the eyelid. So remember, 2 millimeter of the cornea is covered by the superior eyelid. Okay, so the patient would not have any diplopia in these base cases. Okay, chalo, is it clear? So it would be covered by the eyelid, so the patient would not have any diplopia. So the patient would not have a diplopia. Let's move to the next question. Okay, so patient after undergoing a YAG iridotomy comes for the checkup. This patient Harsh, he still has 25 millimeter of mercury pressure on maximum medication. Let's say I started after doing iridotomy, I gave PG analogs, I gave beta blockers, I gave carbonic anhydrase inhibitors, I gave Rho kinase inhibitors, I gave alpha agonist. So everything I gave, even still the IOP is not decreasing. So what is your next step of management? Try to answer. So question is, after iridotomy still it is not decreasing, what is your next step of management? So the answer here is D, that is trabeculectomy. So remember, sometimes students ask me, sir, trabeculectomy has to be done in open angle or closed angle. So remember, trabeculectomy is a gold standard surgery that can be done in any type of glaucoma, whether it is a primary open angle or it is a primary angle closure. Okay, it can be done in all types of glaucoma. Remember, what are the indications? कब की जा सकती है? फर्स्ट थिंग, आईओपी नॉट कंट्रोल्ड ऑन मैक्सिमम मेडिकल थेरेपी. मैंने सब कुछ दे दिया बट आईओपी कंट्रोल नहीं हुआ. सेकेंड चीज क्या होगी कि मैंने पेशेंट्स को बोला कि पेशेंट, इवन इन दीज पेशेंट्स, इफ The patient is not tolerant to medication. आपने कोई भी medication दी उसका untoward side effects होने लग गए. Not tolerant to medication. The third indication is if the patient is not compliant on medication. The patient is a very old age patient. Patient cannot basically purchase the medicines. The patient is from far from flange area where the medicines are not visible or medicines are not available. So in these cases, we can do a surgery which is called trabeculectomy. Okay. So in our case, we are having the high IOP even after doing a iridotomy. So I would prefer doing a trabeculectomy here. Now let's see the other options. Doing another iridotomy, not an option. When you have opened the angles, even if you do a 3 iridotomies or 4 iridotomies, it doesn't make a difference. Trabeculoplasty. Trabeculoplasty is basically a procedure which is initially used in open angle cases, not in angle closure cases. You can basically try this procedure in a patient who has undergone iridotomy, but usually it does not have good results. Ameth glaucoma valve. This is a glaucoma drainage device. It has to be used when the patient has undergone a trabeculectomy and there is a patient of failed trabeculectomy. The IOPs are not controlled even after doing a trabeculectomy, then you can go with the Ameth glaucoma valve. Okay, it has not to be used primarily in a primary open angle glaucoma case. Okay, chal. Let's move to our next question, the stage 3. Sometimes what happens is in trabeculectomy, there is so much fibrosis that it fails. To avoid the fibrosis, we use an agent that is called antimitotic. So out of them, which is the antimitotic I use in trabeculectomy? Your options are sirolimus, bevacizumab, mitomycin, or dexamethasone. So basically what I do in trabeculectomy is I make an opening in the sclera. Okay, this opening in the sclera, I call it ostium. From this opening in the sclera, there is an alternate route of the aqueous humor to pass between the sclera and the conjunctiva. This space I call subconjunctival space. So what happens is it basically is accumulated in the subconjunctival space. The subconjunctival space gets elevated, and this elevated area, I call it bleb. Is it clear, everyone? Just give me a thumbs up. So bleb ka kya matlab hai ki ostium se nikal ke jo aqueous humor hai, wo conjunctiva ke niche aur sclera ke upar accumulate ho jayega, wo conjunctiva ko thoda sa elevate kar dega. Is cheez ko hum bleb bolte hain, bleb. But problem kya hoti hai ki jab bleb banta hai, so there is slowly and slowly fibrosis that goes on. So fibrosis basically can cause the blocking of the bleb and the ostium. So the patient may have a failure of bleb in the later life. To avoid this fibrosis, I can use two agents. The one is mitomycin C and the other one is 5-fluorouracil. Okay, but here comes the main problem. So after successful trabeculectomy surgery, patient presented with the intraocular pressure of 3 mm of mercury and low vision. What can be the most probable diagnosis? Now, this happens because of the mitomycin use. This is a complication of using an antimitotic. Try to answer. So the answer here is A, that is hypotonus maculopathy. Now, any intraocular pressure which is less than 5 mm of mercury, this is called hypotony. This is called hypotony. Now, the basic aim of trabeculectomy surgery is that it basically decreases the IOP. But when it decreases the IOP more than what is required, it basically causes the collapse of the eyeball. It causes, like a balloon, it or a football, you must have seen when the all the air from the football is basically taken out, it basically collapses. So similarly, an eyeball also collapses in this condition. So you may have some undulating curve, ऐसे curvy curvilinear type के pattern दिख रहे हैं. So आपकी eyeball crumble करने लग जाएगी. और when these folds are near the macular area, this causes the basically decrease in the vision. Okay, so this hypotony, which is also associated with the macular issues, this is called hypotonus maculopathy. Are you getting my point, everyone? This is called hypotonus maculopathy, and it is a basically a complication of using a mitomycin C. सो माइटोमाइसिन सी जब हम सर्जरी में यूज करेंगे, व्हाट इट डज इज इट बेसिकली कॉजेस सो मच डिक्रीज इन द स्क्लेरल थिकनेस एंड द कंजंक्टाइवल थिकनेस दैट द टोटल फिल्ट्रेशन दैट हैज टू बी टेकन प्लेस और द टोटल एक्वस आउटफ्लो जो होना था वो जितना रिक्वायर्ड है उससे ज्यादा हो रहा है. ओके, सो व्हाट इज हैपनिंग इज देयर इज अ ओवर फिल्ट्रेशन व्हिच इज गोइंग ऑन. There is a overfiltration which is going on, and this overfiltration is because of the mitomycin C. The other side effects, one is the overfiltration. I write it overfiltration. The other side effects of the mitomycin C is it causes the melting of the sclera. So it basically predisposes the conjunctiva and sclera to the endophthalmitis. So it causes the melting of sclera. It can cause the damage to the cornea and it can also cause a very thin bleb. So it decreases the thickness of the conjunctiva also. So these all are the various indications of the patient, various side effects of the patients having a mitomycin C application. So एक useful भी है बट साइड इफेक्ट्स भी होते हैं. चलो नेक्स्ट क्वेश्चन है. ए पेशेंट केम टू द ओपीडी विद इंट्रा ऑक्युलर प्रेशर ऑफ 24 मिलीमीटर ऑफ मर्करी एंड नॉर्मल ऑप्टिक नर्व एंड विजुअल फील्ड. व्हाट शुड बी द डायग्नोसिस इन दिस पेशेंट? ट्राई टू आंसर. So almost everyone have marked it absolutely correct. The answer is B, that is ocular hypertension. So what is the meaning of these three different terms? Let's see one by one. So the first one is normal tension glaucoma. Second one is ocular hypertension. And third one is preperimetric glaucoma. Okay, so these are the three terms. I write it here. Normal tension glaucoma, ocular hypertension, and the third one is preperimetric glaucoma. Okay, these are the three important diagnoses. First one is the very important is in all of them, these are the open angle glaucomas. So remember, these all are the open angle glaucomas. Now, the other important point that you have to remember is in normal tension glaucoma, there is definitely a optic neuropathy. जैसे मैंने आपको बताया ना, neuroretinal rim thin है, bayonetting sign positive है, cup disc ratio increase है. So these all are others having the optic neuropathy. Plus these patients would have definitely visual field defects. Okay, plus what is the third criteria? Normal tension. So IOP is normal. IOP is normal less than 19 millimeter of mercury. Is it clear, Dr. Sheetal? Okay. What happens in the ocular hypertension? It is opposite to the normal tension. So what happens is the eye pressures are more than 21 millimeter of mercury. But the patient has normal visual field and normal optic nerve. The third one is pre-perimetric glaucoma. So in pre-perimetric glaucoma is that visual fields are normal, but the patient has the optic nerve head changes. Plus, this patient is also having high intraocular pressure. Okay, so why the visual field is normal? You would ask me in this question, because the visual field changes occur when the structural changes of the RNFL already have taken place. So, कहने का मतलब ये है कि पहले retinal nerve fiber layer और ganglion cell जो है वो आपकी damage हो जाएगी, उसके बाद visual field के changes आते हैं. Is it clear? Okay. Now, what is the management of these patients who are having these conditions? So, first of all is, let's see the normal tension glaucoma and pre-perimetric glaucoma. So, both of them are a type of open angle glaucoma. So, what I would do is, I would start with the PG analogs in both the cases. Just give me a thumbs up if you are able to understand this. Now comes the controversy of treating the ocular hypertension or not. So let's say patient is having a 23 millimeter of mercury pressure or 24 millimeter of mercury pressure, and he does not have any other risk factor. The patient is non-diabetic, non-hypertensive. He can follow up with you. His everything is normal. Corneal thickness is normal. He is having no risk factors. So what I would do is I would just do wait and watch. Serial OCT and serial visual field, serial clinical examination I would do in this patient, and I would not do anything else. But when should I treat a patient of OHT? I should treat a patient of OHT if the eye pressures are very, very high. How much? If it is more than 30 millimeter of mercury. Second thing is, patient is not able to follow. You know, this patient is going to some far off place or some problem in the financial part, he would not come again. Or if the patient have more than two risk factors, what are the risk factors? Thin cornea, family history, steroid responder, diabetes. So if the patient is having more than two risk factors and the patient is having a ocular hypertension also, I would basically treat this patient with a PG analog. Yes, family history of glaucoma is very important. In 10% of the patients, you may have a family history of glaucoma. Okay, chalo, let's move to the next question. A patient on anti-epileptic drugs now complains of progressive bilateral constriction of visual field. Patient should be on which of the following drug? This was a previous year AIIMS question. Try to answer. So the answer here is B, that is vigabatrin. Okay, this is a AIIMS question. You just have to remember the name of the drug. Okay, so now here just I want to ask you two more questions. Any drug which can cause bilateral angle closure glaucoma? Any drug which can cause unilateral open angle glaucoma? Any drug which can cause unilateral angle closure glaucoma? These are the three questions to you. Just give me the answer. Bilateral angle closure glaucoma. First of all, this one. Can anyone answer? So a very, very important drug. have been asked last year. Name is topiramate. Have you ever heard the name? Just give me a thumbs up. Unilateral open angle glaucoma. Very, very important is steroids. Okay. Unilateral angle closure glaucoma. Basically, if the patient has occludable angles and you give a drug which can dilate the patient. Okay. So any anticholinergic. In a patient of occludable angles can precipitate the attack of angle closure glaucoma. Is it clear, everyone? Dr. Rajshekar? Okay, chal, let's move to our next question. So next question is a clinical scenario. A 45-year-old female came to the ophthalmologist for general eye checkup. On examination, her fundus in both the eye was having early non-proliferative diabetic retinopathy. So, an important thing that I have got here is the patient is having early non-proliferative diabetic retinopathy. Optic nerve head was healthy. Cup disc ratio was 0.3:1. Very good. And pressures were also normal, 18 millimeter of mercury. But both the eyes, the patient was having the angles closed. So there are closed angles on gonioscopy. There is no family history of glaucoma. What should be her ideal management? Try to answer. So many of the hints given in this patient. What is your preferred mode of treatment in this patient? So very good. The answer here is B, that is peripheral iridotomy. Now let's see all the options one by one. So first thing that I see here is the patient is having a non-proliferative diabetic retinopathy. So if the patient is having non-proliferative diabetic retinopathy, would I like to have a dilated fundus examination in these patients every 6 monthly? Yes or no? Remember, NPDR can slowly and slowly progress to a PDR or vitreous hemorrhage or traction retinal detachment. Yes or no? Everyone. So any patient of NPDR, I would need to do a dilated examination. Okay. Now, every dilated examination can predispose a patient to go into attack of primary angle closure glaucoma. That is called acute congestive glaucoma. Every dilated examination, if the patient is having a angles closed on gonioscopy. Is it clear, everyone? So to prevent this angle closure glaucoma to happen, I would basically do a iridotomy in the patient. Okay, I would make a hole in the iris so that the patient is now safe. Even if the patient is having a normal IOP and the normal cup disc ratio. Is it clear, Dr. Mom, Bhagirath? So, agar patient normal bhi hai, tab bhi main usme kar dunga, kyunki agar wo dilate karenge, to usko angle closure ka attack precipitate ho sakta hai. Okay? That's why I would basically prefer a peripheral iridotomy in this patient. Okay? Chalo. Let's move to the next question. Now I told you that the antimitotic has a lot of side effects. Like the patient may have some scleral melting, overfiltration, scleral thinning, conjunctival bleb formation, which is more thin in characteristic. So lots of potential side effects are there of the mitomycin C. Okay. New implant is now used, which acts as an antifibrotic, as well as it basically decreases the chances of scleral melting also. What is the name of this new implant? Are you getting my portion? सो एक ऐसी चीज है कि जो माइटोमाइसिन सी है वो एंटी फाइब्रोटिक तो है लेकिन वो बहुत सारी प्रॉब्लम क्रिएट कर देती है। ठीक है, एक नया इम्प्लांट आया है जो कि देखिए, रिमेंबर इट इज इम्प्लांट विच इज व्हाट इज डूइंग इज इट इज बेसिकली डिक्रीजिंग द चांसेस ऑफ स्क्लेरल मेल्टिंग ऑल्सो। ओके, द नेम ऑफ दिस इम्प्लांट इज ओलोजन इम्प्लांट, इट इज अ टाइप ऑफ कोलाजिनस इम्प्लांट। ओके, सो एक कोलेजन के केक्स होते हैं वो हम स्क्लेरा के ऊपर लगा देते हैं। सो व्हाट इट डज इज इट बेसिकली डिक्रीजेस द चांसेस ऑफ स्क्लेरल मेल्टिंग। नाउ फ्यू ऑफ द स्टूडेंट्स हैव बेसिकली आंसर्ड अहमद ग्लूकोमा वेल्व एंड एक्सप्रेशन, दीज आर द वंस विच आर अल्टरनेटिव ऑफ ट्रेबेक्यूलेक्टमी। रिमेंबर दे आर द अल्टरनेटिव ऑफ ट्रेबेक्यूलेक्टमी, दे डू नॉट हैव एनी रोल इन डिक्रीजिंग द चांसेस ऑफ स्क्लेरल मेल्टिंग। आर यू गेटिंग माई पॉइंट? जस्ट गिव मी अ थम्स अप। तो उनका स्क्लेरल मेल्टिंग से कोई लेना देना नहीं है, वो तो सिर्फ एक अल्टरनेटिव है कि अगर आपका ट्रेबेक्यूलेक्टमी फेल हो गया तो आपने ये कर दिया। ओके, सो दिस इज द बेसिक फंडा ऑफ एजीवी एंड एक्सप्रेशन। आर्गस इम्प्लांट इज टोटली डिफरेंट, इट इज बेसिकली अ एपी रेटिनल इम्प्लांट विच इज बेसिकली यूज इन द पेशेंट्स ऑफ रेटिनाइटिस पिगमेंटोसा एंड ARMD। Is it clear? So this is the basic funda of the patient who is having a mitomycin C toxicity. Now, can you see this blep? So you are, this is a conjunctival blep. Okay. And can you see there is a very, very minimal vascularization here. Normally the conjunctiva is having a bit of vascularization. So ballooning ho jati hai, iske andar aqueous bhara hua hai, ye overhang kar cornea ke upar aana shuru kar jata hai. इसको हम ब्लैब बोलते हैं, ओवरहैंगिंग ब्लैब। दिस इज समथिंग विच इज बिकॉज ऑफ द टॉक्सिसिटी ऑफ द माइटोमाइसिन सी। आर यू गेटिंग माय पॉइंट डॉक्टर बालाजी? एवरीवन आसिफ? ओके, दिस इज द ओवरहैंगिंग ब्लैब। ओके चलो, द नेक्स्ट क्वेश्चन इज टू असिस्ट द पेशेंट टू नो विच आई ड्रॉप हैज टू बी पुट। ऑल द एंटी ग्लूकोमा मेडिकेशंस आर प्रिस्क्राइब्ड अ कलर कोड। कलर ऑफ द बॉटल इन पाइलोकार्पिन इज ऑप्शंस ऑरेंज, डार्क ग्रीन, पर्पल और ब्लू। सो बेसिक मीनिंग क्या है कि ग्लूकोमा एक ओल्ड एज की बीमारी है। ठीक है, सो ग्लूकोमा हैपेंस इन अ ओल्ड एज पीपल, दे आर समटाइम्स नॉट हैविंग समवन टू टेल देम एंड टू पुट द आई ड्रॉप्स इन देम। सो एवरी बॉटल एंड दे हैव बैड विजन, सो दे कैन नॉट रीड द नेम्स ऑन द बॉटल ऑल्सो। सो व्हाट हैज बीन डन इज दैट the government has provided that every bottle of glaucoma should have a proper color. So just by seeing the color, the patient would say that, sir, okay, this is a bottle of pilocarpine, this is a bottle of dorzolamide, this is a bottle of bimetoprost, this is a combination bottle. So he can understand that and put them inside the eye according to his convenience. So the color of bottle in the pilocarpine should be dark green in color. Okay, the answer is B, that is dark green. So what are the color codes? If the patient is having a prostaglandin analogs, can you name a prostaglandin analog example? Like travoprost. If the patient is having a beta blockers, okay, beta blockers like timolol. So prostaglandin analogs are light green. Beta blockers are yellow or light blue. Carbonic anhydrase inhibitors like dorzolamide, they are orange in color. Alpha adrenergic agents like brimonidine, they are purple in color. Myotics like pilocarp is dark green in color. And combination drops are dark blue. Like if I combine PG analog with beta blocker, this is a combination drug, this is dark blue in color. Okay, so these are the various color code of the anti-glaucoma medications. Okay, chalo, next move to the next question. The next question is, Humphrey visual field analysis is being presently considered as the gold standard for determining the progression of the glaucoma. Which of the following is not a defect which is attributed to the glaucoma in the visual field? Your options are Seidel scotoma, arcuate scotoma, आइसोप्टर कॉन्ट्रेक्शन और सेंट्रल स्कोटोमा? ट्राई टू आंसर. सो इनमें से कौन सा ग्लोकोमा से कोरिलेट नहीं करता? So this is the last question of the day. I think I know that you all are very much tired, including me. Okay, so the answer here is D, that is central scotoma. Now, Humphrey visual fields, if you can see in this picture, this is a Humphrey visual field. It is a gold standard. Automated perimetry. So all the stimulus that has to become, that is pre-decided. The pattern is pre-decided. We usually take central 24 degree. We take it central 24 degree or central 30 degree of the visual field. Can you see this black spot? What is this black spot called? So this black spot is called blind spot. And this blind spot basically corresponds to the position of the optic nerve head. So why the optic nerve head is blind? Because it does not have the photoreceptors. It does not have the rods and cones, so it comes blind in the visual field. Now, this automated perimetry, this is also called static perimetry. Okay, I would not go into the details of interpretation of this step. Asif, I would take it later in the YouTube session, okay? Because these are the MBBS students, so I think the interpretation of perimetry, we should take another special class because it would take an hour for that. Okay, so this is basically a static perimetry. I would discuss in the perimetry what is the meaning of static and what is the meaning of kinetic perimetry. Here I am just telling you few examples of the defects that are seen in the glaucoma. The first one is that you have the decrease in the field of vision. This decrease in the field of vision, this is called isopter contraction. The degrees are called isopters. So you have called isopter contraction. This is the first visual field defect, though it is not very specific for the glaucoma. Another type of visual field defect is when you get a defect in the paracentral region. What I call this? I call it paracentral scotoma. I call it paracentral scotoma. The third defect that I see sometimes is a defect which is like a seedal, ठीक है, खुरपी होती है ना उस तरह से, seedal, जो boomerang, मोगली का boomerang होता था, like this, this is called seedal scotoma. So these all are the visual field defects which correspond to the glaucomas. But if you get a field defect like this, or something which is around the central, I call it central scotomas, or I also call it centrocecal scotoma. Can any of my friend tell me where we see central or centrocecal scotomas? Can anyone tell me in which condition I see central or centrocecal scotomas? So remember, these are seen when we are having a optic nerve head disorder or we are having a macular disorder. Okay, they are not characteristic of glaucoma, they are characteristic of optic nerve head or macular disorders. Okay, so these are some very, very important points that we have studied regarding the glaucoma. We started with how the changes are in the disc, what are the basic components of the treatment of open angle and angle closure glaucoma, how the gonioscopy looks like, What are the differences between the various types of glaucoma? What are the management of various types of glaucoma? And we also studied about the visual fields. We also studied about the various types of tonometer. So I would be having another class on the challenging scenarios in glaucoma, which would be basically useful for the all the type of students, whether they are the plus subscribers, they are the free subscribers, whether they are the third year students. Only thing that I want is that have a basic reading about everything in ophthalmology. Okay, so Asif, we would describe this in our clinical scenarios, in our clinical teaching, how to do a gonioscopy. You can come to my clinic also, where I do the gonioscopy very regularly. Okay, so thank you very much for attending this session. Those students who want to join the Unacademy Plus program, they can use my code OFTHAL10 to get a 10% discount on whether subscription, whether it is a plus subscription or whether it is an iconic subscription. And you can also see my Numero Uno in ophthalmology series exclusively on the Unacademy Let's Crack Neat PG YouTube channel. There I take small 5 to 10 minute videos regarding specific topics in ophthalmology. We have covered the retina, embryology and the cornea, and we are doing the lens there. If anyone wants the links of these topics, you can just contact me on the Unacademy Let's Crack Neat PG Telegram group. Thank you very much for attending this session. Good night and Jai Hind.